आजकल खेल का बोलबाला है, लेकिन एक ज़माना था जब तस्वीर कुछ और ही थी। उस समय अंतर्राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर बैडमिंटन में भारत का नाम रोशन किया श्री प्रकाश पाडुकोन ने। 1972 में आपने नेशनल जूनियर टाइटल जीता और उसी वर्ष नेशनल सीनियर टाइटल भी, जिसे अगले 7 वर्षों तक आपने बरकरार रखा। फिर 1978 में कॉमनवेल्थ गेम्स में मेन्स सिंगल्स गोल्ड मेडल जीता। 1980 में डेनिश ओपन, स्वीडिश ओपन और उसी वर्ष ऑल इंग्लैंड चैंपियनशिप जीतने वाले आप पहले भारतीय थे। ही हैज़ बीन चेयरमैन ऑफ बैडमिंटन एसोसिएशन एंड कोच ऑफ इंडियन बैडमिंटन टीम, वन ऑफ द फाइनेस्ट बैडमिंटन प्लेयर्स दैट इंडिया हैज़ प्रोड्यूस्ड। ही इज़ ऑल्सो द प्राउड फादर ऑफ द फेमस फिल्म स्टार दीपिका पाडुकोन। खेल जगत में योगदान के लिए आपको अनेक पुरस्कारों से सम्मानित किया जा चुका है, जिनमें प्रमुख है अर्जुन अवार्ड और पद्मश्री। आइए देखते हैं दूरदर्शन आर्काइव से उनकी एक बहुत पुरानी रिकॉर्डिंग।
For the past 2 weeks or so, all of us, and particularly the badminton fans in the country, have been very keen to listen to the late radio news at night, and then early morning, have always been very keen to grab the newspaper to see what one Indian has done in the tournaments abroad. This person happens to be Prakash Padukone. In fact, Prakash did not disappoint us. Every time the news came in late at night, we got the news that he had won, and we were all extremely happy and proud about it. In fact, when the news came that he had won the Swedish Open Championships hands down, I had no doubt in my mind that Prakash was going to lift the All England title. But then we had to wait until it became a reality. And when the final news came that Prakash had won the All England title, beating Swee King in straight 2 games, naturally all of us and everybody in the country was very proud of this great achievement. In fact, we have been getting reports in the newspapers about Prakash's achievement and a bit of more news about his matches. But today we are very lucky, and Prakash is here in the studios, and you are going to see Prakash and also listen to him about his achievements in these tournaments. So before I go and ask a few questions to Prakash, I think I would first, on behalf of all the viewers, like to congratulate him on this magnificent success, and also to wish that he continues this winning the laurels for the country in future also. Yeah. Prakash, this, we welcome you to the studios.
Thank
of
you.
The Doordarshan Kendra. And I'm sure now all the people are very keen, the viewers are very keen to listen to you. After you came back, you have made a press statement and said that against Swee King you slowed down the game. What exactly did you do? Did you give a low service and put the shuttle on the net, or slowing down the game for particularly for the badminton players, what exactly did you do?
Well, I think I mainly concentrated on keeping King on the baseline, and he's definitely better at the net, so I was just keeping a correct good length, and King lost his patience at times, and in trying to finish off the rallies quite early, made a lot of mistakes, and I'm glad that I could keep a very good length that day. It was all my shots were all my shots went right.
Well, I think you must have played a very very high percentage of badminton to have beaten him at such low scores.
Yes, I think I was mainly playing, as you rightly said, the percentage game, just trying to keep the shuttle in the court, and it so happened that King also, instead of playing an attacking game, he fell into my trap, and he wanted to extend the rallies, and once he started doing that, I knew that I had the upper hand, because I think we have an edge once it goes into the rallies. Instead of attacking, he went in for the rallies, and naturally when I got my length, as I said, in trying to finish off the rallies, you know, he made quite a few mistakes.
Well, I think personally that after your performances in the Swedish and the Danish Open Championships, Swiking must have really been very, very nervous even before the start of the match.
Yeah,
and that's, of course, credit to you.
Yeah, it must have had a psychological effect on him, because I've never seen King being so tense before a match. And particularly my performance in the Swedish Open, you know, where I had beaten three Indonesians in a row.
So I don't think this kind of excuse can really wash.
Well, I don't think so, because, you know, as they themselves have mentioned in the press, that instead of the usual 6 months training, he has had only 3 months. Well, the same King beat me in Japan just 2 months back. That was in the last week of January in the World Champions Cup.
And also,
and they did not say anything that time. You know, and only when, until the semi-finals,
exactly.
There was no news about him being not fit or anything.
That is,
and
that
once
is the
he
point.
Was lost in the finals, I don't think...
That is the point, because in the other semi-finals, he has done pretty well. He has beaten all the other...
yeah, till the semi-finals, absolutely, there was no problem at all for him.
You have said that the only stiff opposition, of course, from the scores also, it can be seen, you had from Rudy Hartono.
Yeah,
one
in, time the great,
in the entire circuit.
Yes.
I mean, he was, of course, a great, great champion. What are the strong points you still felt Rudy has?
Well, he's still playing the same type of game, you know, because right from the word go, he goes on the attack, and he very rarely goes on the defense. Well, he must have really been on the top a few years back, but now he's slightly slowed down. But he's still got his speed. At least in the first game, he really played well,
mm-hmm.
and I was on the defense throughout. And his interception of the shuttle from the midcourt and his famous half-court smashes, he's still very effective. It was only during the later part of the second game that when he slowed down, that I got the upper hand, and of course I had a very easy game in the third game, because I won quite comfortably at 15-1.
You talked about speed and power, that he still has his speed and power. I don't know, but I think the present generation and our younger boys somehow have a feeling that it's only the speed and power that gets you somewhere at the top. And I don't quite agree to that point of view. I think you have to have a bit of strategy and excellent stroke play and all that. What do you have to say on this? I mean, is the game coming back to the strategic play, as I call it?
Well, I quite agree with you. You know, I think you've got to have a little bit of speed and power. That is, of course, a must. And then one has got to have the basic strokes and also the necessary fitness and all that. The best way would be to have a combination of both, you know, like the Indian style, that is, we depend mainly on strokes. And you take a little bit from the Indonesians and the Europeans. You have some of their speed and power. And if you can combine both of these, I think that will be the best.
Then that's the surest way to become Prakash, is it? Well, actually, talking of the footwork, I think Hartono also must be having an excellent footwork. Can you tell us, and particularly the badminton players, how should one improve the footwork? I mean, you know, sometimes when the game is going on in the normal manner, it's okay. I mean, you are able to reach. But when you are caught on the wrong foot, by the opponent with a very deceptive drop,
yeah.
or a flick toss, then the second or the third time you naturally want to wait to see what he does, but then you are a split second late for it, and then to go in for these kind of strokes, I mean, that needs a bit of a special footwork. What do you do about footwork? How have you got?
Well, I've been mainly doing a lot of shadow play. You know, we do a lot of actions without the shuttles. You know, we give numbers to the four corners of the four courts, and then you move around these courts without the shuttle. You just call out numbers at random. You just call out 1, 3, 2, 4, and you know, we've got to make the actual stroke. It's quite similar to the shadow boxing. I think this does help in increasing your speed, and at the same time increasing your footwork and also your stamina.
Oh my gosh, I know in my late, say about 5 or 6 years ago, when I saw some of the boys doing the shadow badminton, I tried to do it in less than half a minute, I was finished.
Yes.
So I can imagine how it probably also increases your endurance.
Yes, that it does.
Well, talking of footwork, Prakash, did you have, they say that, you know, normally the badminton players or the tennis players have excellent footwork even on a dancing floor. Now, did you have any dinner and dance after the All England Championship? That was the practice some years ago, I know.
Well,
and then the gentlemen's winner, as they say, and the ladies' winner have to lead the dance.
Yeah, unfortunately,
like
it so happened that from this year onwards, they had cancelled this dinner.
Oh my. Is it something like cancelling, showing your singles final?
No, I mean, this was decided much beforehand. See, what all these years, the All England finals used to be on the Saturday. And they used to have the dinner immediately after the finals. And the whole All England used to last for about 4 days. But since this year, they've increased it to 5 days. And the finals was played on a Sunday. So they had a buffet dinner on the Saturday night.
So you didn't get a chance to show your footwork on the dance floor, but
no.
Are you good at the dance floor in your footwork?
No, I'm not very good at it.
Yeah,
I don't think so.
Well, Prakash, after you have achieved this magnificent success, as I said, I'm sure many of the budding players, the children and the parents also would like that their children take up to this game and become Prakash one day. Now, it is a very difficult decision as you go along through your studies and things like that. And you don't know how far one should go. In my case, I remember in 51, I was runner-up to Krishnan in the junior hardcourt tennis, and immediately after 2 or 3 months, I did well in the CCI badminton tournaments. Now, my father was away at that time, and this was reported in the press, and he wrote, "Nandu, I am so happy that you have done so well in badminton and tennis. What about your studies? When are you going to give a little attention to your books?" So I suppose when giving any facility or encouragement, all the parents would have this kind of a problem on how much to give encouragement. What happened in your case? I mean, were your parents completely for the game of badminton?
No, I mean, my father was pretty strict as far as studies was concerned. But fortunately for me, when I was in the college, most of the season used to be from July to December, or say at the most till January. So I used to play badminton from July to January, and whenever I was in Bangalore, I used to attend classes regularly. And once the season used to get over, that is in January, I used to study for the next 2 to 3 months and appear for my exams in April, May. But that's not the case right now, you know, because almost the game has become perhaps more popular now, and the season is almost right through the
right
year.
I mean, that makes this question a little more difficult. That I mean, how would one now? You see, with the amount of training camps that the Association of India is planning to have, I do not know how the students, if any, are going to sort of adjust to this timing.
Well, I think
and should the association make these camps absolutely compulsory for all the cases?
No, I think they have made a few exceptions. In certain cases when the players had to appear for exams, they have exempted players from attending the camp. And I think they should do it in future also, because of course career comes first.
Yes, so you think so. So I think it is a lesson for the budding and upcoming players to see that they have
they
a very fine blend of the play and the studies.
Yeah,
so
right.
they must,
you know, one should play for about 6 to 7 months and maybe study for at least 2 to 3 months. They can plan their year in such a way that they get enough competition and at the same time have enough time for the studies also, that they can do well in both the fields.
Well, I'm sure taking this tip, many of the children and the players would get after this. But another problem that brings comes to my mind is that we do not have sufficient public courts, as I may call it. Like, for instance, I have a few colleagues in the office who have been transferred from the other places, and they are very keen that they give facility to their children. But the unfortunate part is that unless you are a member of any club,
yes,
you do not get the facility. In other words, we don't have any courts where people can go and reserve and play every day, or say maybe once or twice in a week. What about, I understand that in Bangalore you are now, the Karnataka Badminton Association is building up a badminton court. Are you going to have this facility given to the
Well, I think compared to Bombay, you know, Bangalore cannot boast of so many badminton halls, because I think that as far as badminton is concerned, Bombay happens to be the nursery and it has got the maximum number of courts.
But the unfortunate part is they're not available, as I was saying, to the general public.
No, I think the same problem persists even in Bangalore also. And perhaps if this court comes up, but this will be only a two-court stadium, so this can be let out for the public also in case.
I think that would be the correct thing, so that people who are not members of any club can have their children go and practice on these courts. Well, if we do have these public courts and we have more players, more children playing, probably out of those we will get more and more players for the Thomas Cup.
Yeah.
And particularly for the doubles, as you mentioned, what do you think are chances in the Thomas Cup? I read the statement, but what about the doubles? I think I fully agree with you that the selections have to be on the doubles play.
I think basically we are still quite weak in the doubles. We've never had a good doubles team, especially during the last 5 or 6 years. So I think it takes a long time, because I don't find any good doubles players among the present crop also, because the trend is to concentrate more on the singles. So perhaps it will take a few more years before we can really build up a strong Thomas Cup.
Tell me, you see, when you take individual players, you find them very hard hitting. They seem to be good in defense. I sometimes feel that the service, which is the most important thing in the doubles, is weak.
Yes, that is one of the main reasons. In fact, one of the main reasons why Indonesians are so good in the doubles is because of the service.
Why don't we change our style of serving if the Indonesian service is...
I think we should change, because, but of course it will take a lot of time before one can become a perfectionist in this type of a service. But I think it is worth trying, and I surely hope that some of the youngsters would do this. Yeah.
What about the ladies now? I mean, Ami Gheha played very well, you said. What is the basic quality that we lack in comparison to the...
I think Ami did really play well in the All England, and she won two rounds. She had two good victories against Eva Tvedberg and Takada of Japan, and she lost to Larsen of Denmark. On the whole, I think she did play well, but the other girls, they were going out for the first time, so I think they require a little more experience. The basic thing they lack is they are not as mobile as the Europeans are, and they are not as strong as they are. So they have to do a lot of weight training.
I feel, Prakash, you have particularly done well in the western part of the world, you know, with your Evening of Champions, the Commonwealth gold medal, now these two titles and the All England.
Yeah.
Why do you think you particularly do well in the west?
I think I preferred to play in the west mainly because of the climatic conditions there. You know, I prefer to play in the cold rather than in the heat. In Europe, most of these halls are centrally heated, so even though it is very cold outside the stadium, one does not feel the heat inside the stadium. You know, it's centrally heated. So
would the shuttles make a difference also? I somehow feel that with a player like you, the shuttles must be making a difference, in the sense that RSL shuttlecocks are so beautiful that they're easy to
control. The shuttle actually does not make much of a difference, because they have different grains. So if they are playing in a colder climate, they have different grains of shuttles, and when they're playing in the hot climate, they can always have a different grain. So shuttles is not the main thing.
What kind of shuttles do you think are they going to use in the World Championships when you will be?
They're thinking of playing with Garuda. These are the Indonesian shuttles.
Are you comfortable with Garuda shuttles?
Well, in fact, we played the Swedish Open with Garuda shuttles. Even though they are not as good as the RSL, I think they are quite good.
I see. That means that we can very safely wish and hope that you will do definitely well in the World Invitation, I mean in the World Championship, because the Chinese are not coming.
No, China,
but
they are
only the Indonesian lot that you have just now beaten, so hands down.
Yeah, but I'm sure I'll definitely have a much more tougher opposition in Indonesia, because they'll be playing in the home court and the home conditions, and
they'll
have the advantage of playing in the home. They would be used to playing in the climate. In any case, I think we are also preparing quite well. We are having a coaching camp from the 15th of next month for about a month. And of course, the BI is planning to send a team to Malaysia to play a few matches against them before we go on to Jakarta. And we should reach Jakarta at least a week before the championship, so we should give us sufficient time. I only hope that I'll come back with the world title.
Well, you certainly will. We have that confidence, and I don't think there should be any problem, provided you are as cool as you always are, and fit also. Going through these championships, Prakash, I have experienced this myself so many times, so it comes to my mind. One feels very uneasy, between the time that you have played a match. Supposing you played a match this evening and you have another round tomorrow, and a tough round. This period is very, very tense.
Yes.
And it can unnerve a person. One gets very uneasy. What do you do to ease your tension? Are you fond of reading or music? Or
well, I listen to music sometimes.
What kind?
Well, whatever music is available at that particular time.
Mm-hmm.
And I do a lot of reading, but mainly I prefer to rest. I think that's the best form of getting over
the
strain.
But then when you relax, don't you keep thinking of the match or something like that? You don't like to engage yourself in something else?
No, usually once I go to rest, then I rest completely that day. And I start thinking of the match only the next morning.
I see. Prakash, now that you have this crown on your head, the All England crown, how uneasy do you feel?
It's no doubt, I'm indeed very happy that I won the All England, because this was one of my life ambitions. And of course, it's given me...
Well, I mean, you don't seem to feel uneasy. I mean, you're wearing it with all the ease.
Yeah, I mean, I take it as a part of my career. You know, I don't find very uneasy at all.
Well, I'm sure, Prakash, we would like to wish you the very best in the World Championships, and that you will come back with greater laurels. On behalf of the viewers, I'd like to once again congratulate you and wish you all the best. And thank you for coming to the studios.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.